everyone. Today I have with me Anna LeBaron, and this is Anna's book, and it's The Polygamist Daughter. Thank you so much, Anna, for coming on my show. I'm so happy to meet you.
Well, it's a pleasure, Michelle. Thank you for having me.
I was so nervous that I would say Anna because I have a daughter that's Annie. Oh. And I was so nervous because I was like, I hope I say Anna right. But, you know, Frozen has definitely helped you.
Oh, absolutely, 100%. Frozen came out and all of a sudden my name is legit.
Isn't that awesome?
I'm so happy about that.
That's right. It like became one of the most popular names ever just because of Frozen. So that's awesome.
I mean, I say now, I introduce myself. Hi, my name is Anna, like the girl in Frozen.
There you go. And
almost everybody says, oh, and then they have a way to remember my name because I've associated it with something else that's already in their brain.
Exactly. And I was so touched by your book, and I know everybody is, and I'm sure you hear it thousands and thousands of times, but for people like me, I grew up in an abusive household, okay? But I was with my dad 24/7, okay? So, of course, when I'm reading your book, what goes through your mind is like, which is better? You didn't really know your dad. I knew my dad oh so well, you know? And you kind of make those comparisons, and your story, it just, you know, that's what I'm saying. Like, at times, I just, like, broke down crying as I was reading it because it's... Anybody who's suffered, who's listening to this and who has suffered any kind of childhood abuse, it's always on the surface, and there's anything can make it, bring it back, you know, you can kind of snap and it's right there, you know?
It's triggering for some people.
Yes.
So before we go any further, I want to tell your listeners that because I'm aware of that triggering that happens for some people that have experienced trauma or any kind of abuse, I have provided on my website in under the book link or the book tab some resources. And one of them is some journal prompt questions that the reader can answer and go through that will help this reading of this book become a healing journey instead of just a triggering thing with no place to take any of that emotion that bubbles up to the surface.
Yes. And that's why I wanted everybody to know, like, you don't have to, it doesn't have to be the same kind, you know, it doesn't have to be occult abuse or, you know, or sexual abuse like mine was. It doesn't have to be a specific. The thing with abuse is that, and I heard you tell someone this, and I love the way you phrased it, is that it's an onion and there are these layers. And every time you think, so you get through the one part and then then, you know, you go through another and you're like, there's a part of you that's like, I'm 52, you're in your 40s. Like, some days you wake up and you're like, isn't it over today? Like, is today the day that there's no more to deal with? You know, because it doesn't feel fair. It doesn't feel fair because it wasn't our fault. And it doesn't feel fair that we're the ones having to go through the process, you know?
Right.
And that's what I got from you.
The injustice of it all is something that I worked my way through.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to me. And so what I also want to say is that there are some abuses that are called hidden abuse, mm-hmm. psychological, emotional, verbal. Those don't leave bruises and scars on your body, but they do leave them on your heart, on your soul, and on the skin of your heart. Those bruises are there. And so I think many readers will identify with that mm-hmm. and have, you know, kind of be able to relate to my experiences and the themes of my book, the abuse, the neglect, the lack of provision and the lack of protection that should have been there. And my father, you know, the way he was completely absent from my life, except a handful of times. And sometimes a father's presence can be what is also needing to be healed from if they're abusive or distant or emotionally not present or emotionally not available.
Yeah. And, you know, the difference is, okay, your dad is known, you know, he's like, well, obviously, like, he's this popular guy. People love him. For everybody who's just tuning in, your dad's name was, I don't even know if I want to say this right, Ervil?
Ervil.
Okay, Ervil LeBaron. And So he's this like figure, and you idolize, you know, not only you and your brothers and sisters, but he was kind of idolized. And it's interesting because I'm watching your videos. My dad, in a smaller way, was idolized. And when you said that, you know, you felt like he had a mental abuse, a mental, you know, problem, I was like, yeah, they say that. And let's just say that that's true, right? Let's just say, yes, they had mental issues. Of course they did. But is that okay? You know, just because they, you know, like I found myself giving my dad a lot of excuses because of his, and I'm sure you did the same thing as you were going through what you went through. It's like, it helps, but then it doesn't help. It helps. And then, you know,
it helps you cope for the time being until you get to the place where emotionally you are prepared and ready to kind of unpack the abuses that happened and the emotional scars that are there. And when you're ready for that, then you stop making excuses for it.
Right. And I made excuses for years for him, for his, you know, and.
But it's a human and normal thing.
Yes. Yes.
That just lends itself to displaying just how human and normal you are. That was the process that you went through in order to cope and in order to get to the place where you are today or where you were when you started to kind of unpack that. It's a coping mechanism and it helps keep body and soul together until you get to the place where the healing journey can begin or move forward.
And that's what I loved about, like, I loved you in the book, but when I went on your website and I saw that, you know, you are so desperate to help other people. Like, you went through probably worse than I've ever heard of. But now that you're on this side of it, like, you just want to help other people who were abused. And it's almost like you can, because people will listen to you, especially after reading your book, because they can't sit there and say, you don't understand. You understand. You do understand.
I understand a lot.
Yeah. And you know, sometimes, yeah. And I love how you went to, you know, counselors that actually, you know, when they said, well, this one isn't going to help you, I kind of went through the same thing. They have to find somebody that's going to be a fit. And then that's what actually led to your undertaking of, you know, figuring it out and years of, you know, going through it all. But okay, so I keep wanting to, like, I got to back up for everybody. So,
because
I already read the book, so I want to back up for you. So you had at least 50 brothers and sisters.
Mm-hmm.
Your mom was one of 13 of his wives.
Yeah.
I think that the shows that have been on it, people can relate a little bit because there's been some television shows that have, you know, portrayed it maybe in too much of a light instead of what really it's like. I think it kind of portrayed it in a, you know.
Well, if you're talking about the TLC show called Sister Wives, that show does portray it in the best light that I've ever seen any type of polygamy portrayed in.
Oh, that's good. That's not the one I was thinking of. So that's good. If that one does, what's the other one with the guy that just built?
There was one called Big Love.
That's it.
On HBO. And I don't think that's airing anymore, but that show probably had more dynamics and more correlations with the way I grew up. The dark part of that experience with Big Love, the show Sister Wives, on the TLC channel, that one is very different from the what I experienced and from what probably 99% of other people that I know that have experienced a polygamous background have experienced. So what I love about that show is that they are allowing their children to choose whether they want to continue living that way or not. They're giving their children real freedom of choice. To where we were told that we had, quote, free agency, but we really didn't. Mm-hmm. We did not have a choice. We were groomed and we were brainwashed and taught that one day we would become somebody's sister wife.
Right.
And a little detail about this show is Christine Brown is my cousin.
I heard that.
She is, her grandfather and my father are brothers.
Wow.
And so I think that makes us first cousins one generation removed.
Yeah.
She doesn't know me. I follow her on Twitter, and that's the extent of it.
Yeah, and, you know, people don't really get what it, I mean, reading your book, I really understood somehow when you hear about how it is, you know, there's always these jokes like, oh, that would be so easy, you know, you live with all these moms that are taking care of all these kids and, you know, but I didn't understand was the fact that the poverty, you know, because of not having, you know, I'd never envisioned that when I've heard about it. I pictured this like clan of happy people who, you know, somehow make money and they get to feed all these kids and they get to, like, that is nothing. Like, that is nothing. I mean, it was so eye-opening when I'm reading your story and I'm like, well, duh, like, how did you... You do have a lot of children to feed. And that one point when you had people fighting over who was going to take care of you because they were so overwhelmed with children, you know, and your mom isn't around. And then, like,
Is that a being sent back and forth on the bus?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. That was such a crazy day.
Like, you actually, and you didn't really even understand until you got older, probably, like, what the problem, like, did you understand that they didn't want you?
Or no, didn't understand that, and I didn't understand why everybody was upset with me, because I was getting conflicting messages about where I was supposed to be, and at 9 years old, being sent back and forth from one city to another on a bus, by myself.
Right. And that took place in Mexico. I mean, you're not in the United States getting on a little, you know, Bieber bus going back. Like, you are in Mexico getting on this bus. Like, they're just sending you. And you know, you don't, like I said, you don't have your mom and you have siblings. And didn't you have siblings in both places? Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah.
Yes. So you were sent out.
Yeah. I mean, nobody can imagine that. Nobody can, you know. There are just no words, you know, but
it's so wrong, and
I'm sure, you know, like, you want to look back on those women and try to understand that they're starving, their children are starving, you know, they're in Mexico, it's not a good place, you know, they're not having fun either, this isn't right. Like two women who are having fun, right. You know.
I don't want to say anything disparaging about the people that were trying to do the best they could, but they were also under duress and in very difficult circumstances.
Yes.
They were just doing the best they could,
right. Even
though the results of their best efforts still left me in a situation that no child should ever be in.
Was it your age? Like, I was trying to figure out why it was you. Was it because you were, like, not little, but you weren't grown? So was it just the fact that you were 9 and, like, an in-between? So you couldn't be as helpful as if you were 13 or 14, but you weren't a baby that needed to be taken care of. So there seemed to be that's what I felt when I was reading, like, there seems to be this, like, middle age that they're, like, they almost don't like because it's hindering in a weird way. You know, you're not little and you're not big, you know?
Yeah, I don't have any explanation for it. I mean, I was doing my part. I was working and being put to work at 9. So I was doing what I was told. I wasn't being a problem that I'm aware of.
Well, I didn't mean a problem. I just meant like that there were, you know, when the kids reached a certain age of like not babies, it seemed like until, you know, but if you're right, because at 9 you were like actually working, like doing, you know, and probably taking care of little kids too.
Yeah. That was just a life that we all led. And I wasn't just one singled out. In this book, I really did my best to tell my story and not tell other people's stories because those are theirs to tell.
Yes.
So that's why I wasn't focusing on other children around me or my siblings and what was happening to them. And unless they were, you know, immediately involved in what was happening to me, I really did my best to give everybody else an opportunity to tell their own story.
Yeah, and I thought you did that really well because there were actually siblings that had, like, I felt like they were missing. I was like, where's this sibling? Like, I thought you did really well in just telling your story and not where they were or what they were going through at that time.
And also, the reader was experiencing exactly the same thing I was experiencing.
Mm-hmm.
Where are they? Where did they go? they up and moved in the middle of the night, or somebody took them somewhere else, and I don't know where they are until they show back up years later or months later. And we're taught not to ask any questions. So as people are moved and people came in and out of the home, usually in the night, so we didn't know who, from when we went to bed and woke up the next morning, who would still be in the home when we woke up, or who would have arrived in the middle of the night. So people were moved in and out, siblings were moved in and out, and we were just taught not to ask questions. So we could not see a sibling for a while, and then all of a sudden they show back up. So my readers got to experience that exact same thing that I was going through of not knowing. Right. And then all of a sudden, okay, here in chapter 4, one of them is gone, and now in chapter 12, they come back in the picture all of a sudden. That was how my life was.
Yeah, especially with your close siblings, like the ones that were close around your age, like that must have been, because you get attached, and then all of a sudden, you're not even understanding why they're not there anymore. Like, because your sibling, you know, like, and they were, some of them were your real siblings, you know, as opposed to half siblings, and, you know. And all that stuff. So that was crazy. But I was actually telling somebody about, you know, I was reading this book and what was going on, and he actually remembered it.
Wow.
He does. He remembered it. He's my age. He's 52. And he said, I actually remember when that went down in the 80s. I remember that story. And I was like blown away, because I don't, you know, but it's, Texas is kind of fall, you know, like it's kind of removed, but.
Well, it made national news.
It did, of course. Yeah. And I started going through some of the news things, and I was like, wow, I mean, this was, it was a big deal. You know, it wasn't in my little world, but it was definitely a big deal everywhere else. And you probably didn't even understand that it was such a big deal at that time, you know?
No, I didn't know anything was even going that wrong with, you know, I didn't even know people were dying until I was in my mid-teens. And had already run away from home. And then I got a hold of a book that had been written about my father and went, whoa. So that was just shocking and eye-opening and frightening all at the same time. To learn all of that at once.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, for at your young age of when you did get out, you got out at 13, to have the wherewithal to understand that to not go with your mom must have been a very difficult choice. I know what I felt like at 13 and what I was going through, and I'm not sure that I could have made that same choice, but I think that, you know, it, but you, like, there is something, and I was raised Christian, okay? Mm-hmm. And I was, really in church, in youth group, in everything Christian, okay? And that was the thing that helped me the most, was because I was in youth group and I had somebody telling me, not knowing my circumstances, but that whatever's going on, you know, you have God and you have, you know, like that's what, you know, and I held on to that. Like I really did. You started to find that. I already had it by 13 pretty much. So I could distance myself as those crazy people at 13, you know, that I could detach a little bit, you know?
Yeah. Well, it was the injustice of what was happening to my family and my siblings in Denver. And the fact that it was just so horrifying and so horrific, so harrowing, that gave me the wherewithal to say, no, I'm not going back to Denver, when I had experienced life in Houston for a while that seemed and felt more normal and better than any life that I had led up until that time. So it was that the difficulty of life in Denver versus what we had experienced in Houston that was so much better, that gave me the wherewithal to make that choice, make that decision, because I did not want to go back to the life that we had in Denver.
Was it just about the work, or were there a lot of other abuses that were going on in Denver that made you aware?
There was definitely abuse happening that was just horrific. Now, it wasn't always happening to me, because I was a very compliant child and did what I was told, but I witnessed beatings happening to my siblings that had just a little bit of, you know, resistance or rebellion, if you will, or just the fact that they were complaining about what was happening to us in Denver. They would just get beaten for not producing or not, you know, for back talking or, you know, complaining. And so I just kept my mouth shut, put my head down, and did what I was told. So that didn't happen a lot to me, but it did happen, but just not a lot.
And did your mom not have a say when once she would get you to Denver? Like, you knew that once she got you to Denver that she was not going to be able to save you, right? Because she didn't have – there were other people that were in control of the work that you had to do, right? It wasn't like she
– She was being worked her own self. We all had to work.
Oh, she was being worked. Okay.
All of us had to work. And she had to work in Houston too. So there's no difference, but we weren't worked like slaves in Houston. In Houston, we would work normal people hours, and we would actually get paid for our work.
Oh.
And that was a huge difference.
Yes.
And we would get to go roller skating on Friday night consistently. There was some predictability and normalcy to life that we had in Houston, and it was better than anything I had ever known in the 12 years that I had lived up to that point.
Yeah. Did you go to a public school in Denver, or did they keep you working? Was it because I remember, like, you had, there were some grades that you also were missing at some point. And is that because they would keep you home from school to work?
No, it's because we moved around so much.
Oh, it was because you, okay.
We were very transitory, moving in the middle of the night, you know, at the drop of a hat, you know, weeks, months in, at a time in a, one place, and then, oh, we're moving again and moving again. And when, as long as you were young, you were enrolled in public school because it was like free childcare, so that the adults could work.
Oh, right.
Soon as you got to an age where you started exploring, you know, anything that was considered worldly, you know, liking boys or wanting to be fashionable or, you know, just seeing the world around you in a different light, as soon as you became aware that there was something different and better, they would pull you out of school and make you work. If you weren't causing a trouble and you were doing fine in school, then they would kind of let you stay there. But as soon as you became, if they needed workers, they would pull you out of school if you were old enough. Or if you were becoming worldly, they would pull you out of school.
Yeah, and that's what I wanted to show on your cover so that people can see, because this is the normal dress.
Yeah.
This is the fabric that they put across. And, you know, I've known people in other cults, not this cult, but in other cults. And it's weirdly like there are cults under the name of Christianity. You know, there's crazy on every, you know, in every kind of religion. And I knew Christians that did this exact same thing. To their, to, you know, so it's interesting, you know, to me when I was I was like, that is a theme. Like they really try to keep the girls like very proper and very, no sexual, you know, and you have girls and I have girls and, you know, we know, I went through a little bit of it even what, because any religion, when I was looking for it, it started to make sense because of what happened to me. And then I was watching my daughters grow up and I don't know, did you experience any leftover, like watching my daughters also, then I started to pull them back in, not wanting them to be out there and experiencing sexuality in a way that I was exposed sexually. And I don't know, like as a mom, like, did you have to go through some of those leftover, you know?
Oh, 100%. In the back of the book, there's a Q&A with the author that's been published in the book. And I probably cried more writing that, answering that question in that Q&A than any other thing. Because growing up the way I did, it did affect how I mothered my own children. Mm-hmm. And the mistakes that I made, you know, within the parenting process. And I'm just so fortunate in that my children still love me and, you know, want to hang out with me. So I feel like their forgiveness and, you know, their ability to just be kind and generous with me, with their love, in spite of the mistakes that I made in raising them. That's just one of the greatest gifts I'll ever receive.
Yeah. I know. I had no idea until they started to get older, you know, like then hindsight and you're like, Yeah, I feel the same way. It's just like,
now, if I could go back and do it over again, I would do it so differently. And we know we just don't get that chance.
We don't get that chance. And I have a very wide range. My children are way more spread out than yours. So I still have a 14-year-old. I have a 30-year-old and I have a 14-year-old. But I've, you know, with my last two children, it's like I've been able to breathe. Like, okay, yeah. It does work out okay. It does, you know, like.
I compacted mine a lot more closely together, yes. The five of them.
You did.
Boom, 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 boom. So my age range, my youngest is 18, and she graduates in June. Aww. So I'm doing the happy dance, man. Getting that last one graduated is going to be such a happy day for me.
Yes.
My oldest is 25.
Nice.
So nice and compact, all of them just in a row and stair-step down and...
Yeah. And overwhelming. Yes, exactly. It's, you know, yeah, it's very over.
It's overwhelming. And I'm so glad to be on this side of it. You know, I wanted to have 8 kids when I was a younger girl. When I was a teenage girl, I thought 8 would be the perfect number of children. And, you know, once I had 5, I realized, oh my gosh, what have I done?
I know. I used to always think 6 because of the Brady Bunch. Because I was on my shows and I was watching the Brady Bunch and then I was like, okay, I want 6. But I did used to, when I'd be pregnant, people would say, what number is that? And I'd lie because I was like, who has 5 children? That's so absurd. Why would you do that?
Yeah, 5 is a lot in our culture. And
that's right. And that's, your mom had 5 or did she have 6?
No, my mom had 12.
What?
My mom had 12 children.
How did I miss that?
I'm not sure.
I missed that in the book.
She had 5 children before she met my dad.
That's right. Those are the ones I'm missing.
And had 7 with my father. So for a total of 12. So right. I have 7 full siblings and 5 half siblings.
That's right. I forgot about the fact that she had been married. So your mom was she married into a polygamist relationship before your dad? Or was that a regular marriage? Yeah. How did it, do you know, like, I mean, I know she's still alive, but do you know what happened in that would be so attractive to her to change her lifestyle like that?
Well, my mom was raised in the traditional LDS Mormon faith.
Right.
And so what happened was my father believes and teaches or taught the original tenets of that faith as taught by Joseph Smith and Brigham Young.
Okay.
So but the Mormon church, the modern day version has disavowed polygamy back in 1890. And so there were numerous people that continued practicing that tenet of their faith in spite of the prophet of the LDS church having disavowed it. And so those people became known as fundamentalist Mormons, even though there's some language struggle with the word Mormon, just because people that are modern day LDS Mormon say that if you're practicing polygamy, you're not a real Mormon.
Right.
So I don't know a better way to say it besides fundamentalist Mormon.
Right.
And so therefore I have this little language problem. But that's when my mother was taught by my father before she, you know, became interested in him or, you know, married him spiritually, I guess. When she was sitting under his teaching and he's telling her about the original tenets of that faith. And, you know, because in my father's opinion, the modern day LDS church are the ones who apostatized and stopped teaching what Joseph Smith originally taught.
Right.
So that was my father's version, and my mother bought into that and said that this is a doctrine that can never be undone. I'm not sure what they have texts, sacred texts to them that talk about that. And so when my father is teaching her this, then she was able to see what she wanted to see, and she was converted to the fundamentalist faith of the Mormon
That actually makes sense to me. No, but it's true. Like, I can see that. Because I do have Mormon friends, and I can see that at the right time, right frame of mind, you know, if you really were a Joseph Smith, if you believed in what he said, like, that would be, you would be like, yeah, why are people changing it? That's what he said. That was originally what he said, you know?
Right.
So I can...
That's the reason why she was able to be converted, is because she didn't understand the, or didn't know that those texts and those scripture references were there, that the way Joseph Smith taught them. And it wasn't just like the Book of Mormon, it's the Doctrine and Covenants, the
yes.
Pearl of Christ, and,
yes.
you know, Brigham Young's writing. You know, all of those are out there and available if anybody wants to read it. It's not like I'm making it up.
Right, it's there. No, I mean, I think that everybody knows that that is what he taught. I mean, I know that. But did
Smith practice polygamy?
Right, he did. Yes. Yeah.
And that's something that even the modern day LDS church has now admitted and talked. They now talk about it, mm-hmm. the fact that it is a reality. And mm-hmm. so before it was kind of something that they wanted to not focus on,
mm-hmm.
but with the internet and with the power of, you know, people being able to do research and all of that,
right.
it's something that has been brought into the light, and it's a discussion that a lot of people feel like needs to happen.
Right. Did you see them get along? Did they really, like, get, you know, because three of them or so would be together at any point. I mean, did they really get along as women and functioning, you know, with raising the children?
They did the best they could.
Mm-hmm.
However, a polygamous relationship is not a natural relationship.
Right.
A woman does not naturally share her husband
right.
with their romantic interests.
Right.
No matter how you want to look at that, it's not natural to
right.
share a husband. And so having to take those emotions that you feel that are normal and natural and just press them down and squelch them inside of you and not speak them and not voice them, it just makes the human experience limited.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have the range of human emotion.
Makes
that
you very numb. Yeah.
You can't, you know, researcher and storyteller Brené Brown says it like this: you can't selectively numb your emotions. If you numb the negative emotions, you're also numbing the positive ones. And so I watched that happen to the women around me that were living polygamy,
mm-hmm.
and we were being groomed to also live exactly that same way, to numb the emotions, to numb the needs and wants and desires that we had that are natural, and to just not speak those things.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were taught and groomed to become sister wives eventually when we became of marriageable age, which in our group was right around age 15, when they were starting the discussion of who you would eventually marry.
Mm-hmm.
And sometime after age 15, you would get married off, and usually to an older man in the group. Very rarely did age mates that were interested in one another, very rarely were they allowed to take that, you know, relationship to its fruition and get married. It happened, mm-hmm. but not very often.
I was thinking... The reason that they had so many children, too, was because they wanted to promote, they were trying to make it the group larger, correct? Like, I mean, it was like, the more children you could have, but then at a certain point, it's like, it starts to get confusing as to cousins and, you know, like, how you're related, you know, in some way. And, you know,
yeah.
it doesn't really work, but I can see why they would think that it would work to get the community bigger,
right?
Even though it was hard to feed that many children and stuff, they were thinking growth, growth, growth,
right?
You know,
yeah.
And
birth control is not practiced among those communities for the most part. So,
right. because that wouldn't have been, well, yeah, that wouldn't have been acceptable in any way, because they were supposed to have kids. That's what they were supposed to do, you know? So it does, you know, I understand. It's, you know, I have so many, I'm very grateful that your sister, which we didn't even get into, but I mean, your sister got you out, and she, the thing that touched me about her, Lillian, was that when you would talk about how she always promoted that everybody had to be happy, okay? So even she was in herself, like, not wanting to express an emotion also. Like, it was like, I understand, you know, it's weird because it's like, well, I get it in a way, because as having children, you're like, you want them to be happy. You want everybody should be happy. Why should we dwell on, you know, she probably had a lot of negativity in her life. So let's just, you know, all be happy because we have so much more than I had. And, you know, we all, but in a weird sense, it also got her, which is why I think she couldn't deal with a lot of what she had to deal with then, you know, because her emotions were so stuffed, you know, down inside.
We didn't have an outlet for being able to process a lot of the negative experiences. And even me living with her, I had not experienced nearly as much as she had, as far as pain and anguish, you know, experience. She was much older than me, and so she had much more experience and much more knowledge about what was happening. And, you know, the deaths of people and things that had happened. And so she was carrying a lot more pain than even I was. And as far as I know, you know, it wasn't a thing where she was going to counseling or until it was pretty much too late. Mm-hmm. And so my experience was, it took me until I was in my mid 30s, I believe, maybe mid 20s, when I started going to counseling. It was 1995, mm-hmm. so almost 30, right, when I started going to counseling and began the healing journey and finding voice and finding a safe space to be able to voice the negative things that had happened and the traumas and the abuses and process through those things. So she had not had that opportunity.
Right.
And so that affected her greatly, mm-hmm. and many other people.
Right.
And so I'm one of the fortunate ones that has pursued the healing and the counseling, professional counseling, mm-hmm. and processed through a lot of it. So I feel very fortunate that I'm on that other side of the healing journey enough to where I can tell my story without being re-traumatized by it.
And that is it's such a refreshing place, like, to be at, even though, like, reading it, I'm, like I said, there were triggers and there were things that, you know, I had to put it down and kind of, you know, but it's nice when you can get to a certain point that you can talk about it without, you know, without it being too difficult and being able to experience, because like I said, this is going to help a lot of people. There are a lot of people that need to read this and go through it a little, you know, if you're at the right place, this is the perfect place to take you through a journey of it. And the back, like, it touched me so much when you did answer those questions, because I thought that was, after reading the book, it, like, I don't know, it brought the book even more to life. You know, you talking about when people are like, what I'd want to know as the reader, and then you being as honest as you can be about it. And, you know, and I didn't even realize, I mean, they asked you the question of, like, do you still feel safe? And I was like, she wouldn't feel safe. Like, and I was like, wow, that is a consider, you know, who, I didn't even think of that, you know, cause it seems like it's in the past and it's not even something to even consider, but, you know, it was still something that you did have to address.
It is a question that you asked consistently.
Mm-hmm. And did you think about that when you were writing it, or you felt like, no, it's good, it's a good time?
I knew I was safe. If I had thought for even one second that I was putting myself or my children or people that I love in danger by sharing my story, mm-hmm. I would have never gone public with it at all.
Right. And you went back to your name. I wanted to know, like, is that because you want that, you know, like, you want to be like, that's me, like, you know?
Well, I do say in the Q&A that I did get divorced again. Mm-hmm. So I went back to my maiden name when that happened.
Right.
So So that's why I have my maiden name. That's my legal name now.
Right. Well, I also was married to a Marine, by the way. That was my first husband.
Yep. Why?
So I found that really interesting because I was like, there's so much we have in common. We even married a Marine as our first husband. So
I'm now proud to be a LeBaron. I have not been able to say that my whole life.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you're embracing, because I know even with my maiden name, I go back and forth between my married name, where I have children that are that name. And I'm like, I go back and forth because there's something about it that you have to embrace, you know? And I'm there most of the time. But, you know, I was like, she must really be there. She wants to, you know, you don't have to. Nobody's, you know, making you take that name back, but, you know.
Yeah. I'm proud of my name. I'm proud that I'm a LeBaron. I'm proud of my family.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone in my family that survived.
Right.
What the harrowing experiences that we went through, that survived and lived, have gone on to lead, you know, good, productive members of society lives, that I'm just so proud of my family and everything that we've overcome.
Mm-hmm.
And all the ways in which we're now creating lives for ourselves and our families that are just rich and in human experiences and good.
Yeah.
We're connecting and reconnecting ways that are so meaningful to me and to everyone.
That's awesome. Is Celia, are you still close with her?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
She edited every single one of those chapters with me, sitting right beside me. So.
I'm really happy to hear that. After, you know, that was one of the questions I was like, I have to ask her if she's at least connected to Celia. So that's awesome. Thank you so much, Anna. I've learned so much, and I really want to tell everybody to go get this. This is a book of hope. It is not a, it's not just about sad. It's about what is possible to go through and to be on the other side of, and, you know, and
there's redemption and restoration as part of the themes of the book that I really am proud of and really happy to be able to share with
you. And you should be, and you should be. And I'm so proud of you. And thank you so much for being able to tell your story, because it will help a lot of people, you know, and you will.
I'm grateful to be at this place where I can.
Awesome. And you can find her on all types of social media. I will have all the links underneath her video. And she is coming to bookstores near you very quickly, right? You're going to be making a big circuit, and go out and see Anna and get her to sign your book, because that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah. The events that I'll be where I'll be showing up are going to be posted on my website, annalebaron.com. And you'll find that under the You and Me tab where it says speaking, where I'll be. And so those are confirmed events. And there's other ones that will be showing up as we get those confirmed. So check back, and hopefully we'll come to a city near you and we can meet.
And I'm sure you have more books in you. So I think we'll be seeing more of you, because, you know, there are more stories to tell. And, you know, I can't wait to hear them. So thank you so much. And we will be chatting soon.
Thank you so much, Michelle.
Okay, bye-bye, Anna.